can you see that now?
Yes, yes.
Okay, thanks. So first of all, I'd like to thank IFAS, Kumar Shantanu, Rajiv Raman, Dr. Anoop for inviting me here. And really, I'm thankful for that. It's basically, I think it's a great initiative getting these video techniques. And I've been asked to speak on arthroscopic ankle arthrodesis. Going from all the open techniques, now we have a slightly minimally invasive ankle arthrodesis, but this is isolated ankle arthrodesis. So we want to just see where we want to use this. What is the indication of an isolated ankle arthrodesis? It's mainly ankle arthritis, end-stage ankle arthritis, which is a really debilitating condition. If the patient has it, difficult to walk on it, there's deformity, you can have gait abnormalities. And there's a lot of morbidity associated with an ankle arthritis, even though it may not seem much on the x-ray, but the patient is really debilitated with these problems. So it is something which we need to treat. And there are conditions where, we were not going to debate where you're going to do an ankle replacement or an ankle arthrodesis. But ankle arthrodesis is a more sure shot condition, especially for some patients where, where you want to be more heavy activities, and is not really sedentary, then you want to go for more sure shot operations such as an arthrodesis. Now, you can do that open or arthroscopic. For arthroscopic, the initial indications are minimal to moderate deformity. However, I think as you grow in experience, you can tackle much more deformity, which you thought you would do only do on open arthrodesis. You can tackle arthroscopically later on, but it's got a learning curve. You have to have minimal shortening, so you don't really need graft or interpositional graft because you can't do that arthroscopically. And you can start off with isolated ankle arthritis, although a hind foot nail with a hind foot arthrodesis can also be done arthroscopically eventually, because you can either use a posterior approach to approach both the ankle and subtalar joints, which is what I do, or you can do two separate approaches, the anterior for the ankle and lateral for the subtalar arthroscopic preparation, and then you can put a hind foot nail in. It is a long procedure, and sometimes takes longer to prepare the subtalar joint. So majority of my hind foot nails, I tend to do an open procedure. However, for isolated ankle arthrodesis, I tend to not do an open procedure at all, tend to rely on arthroscopic arthrodesis. So that's my main primary indication. The position of arthrodesis is exactly the same as for an open procedure. So arthroscopic, you want to aim for a slight valgus of 0 to 5 degrees. You want neutral dorsiflexion, and you want slight external rotation. And that's the ideal position for ankle arthrodesis. The surgical technique you would do for any ankle arthroscopy is a standard technique for ankle arthrodesis. The only thing which you would require more is traction. You definitely need traction in the majority of cases. You don't need the special ankle scope. You can do well with a 4mm normal knee scope. A 30 degree and a 70 degree scope is also quite handy to reach the back of the ankle and see the back of the ankle. So if you have a 70 degree scope as well as a 30 degree, that is great. You need to have shavers, curettes, you need bone burrs as well, and a microfracture roll is handy. So all these things, these instruments are available to us in all arthroscopic trolleys, really. So you don't need small shavers, small scopes for this kind of procedure. But you need bigger one because it's got a wide angle view. And you do standard anteromedial and anterolateral portals for ankle arthroscopy. Fixation is generally done with cannulated screws, because you can't really put a plate arthroscopically. So you want to fix the screw. So these are the patients whom you really want to, minimize the soft tissue dissection. And these are the patients whom you really don't want to do an open procedure, like some people who have compromised skin, swelling, diabetes, neuropathy. Sometimes you don't really, you don't need to sort of make an open incision there, or you have scars where you can't really approach the ankle very well. And then you can do an arthroscopic. So that's where it's really arthroscopic is really in its comes into its own. So if you come, let's look at this patient who's a 42-year-old female who's rheumatoid arthritic. She's got a very painful ankle on one side. On the right side, you can see that the ankle joint is almost completely obliterated. She still had movement of the ankle, movements of the midfoot and subtalar joints were retained. So we did not choose to, include any of the other joints in the fusion, and did an isolated ankle fusion, planned for an isolated ankle fusion. Now this case you can see is, you know, she's not got any deformity there of the ankle, which is a bonus. So you don't want to correct any deformity there. But the bad thing about this approaching arthroscopically is that the space in the ankle will be very limited. So you have to work your way from the front to the back, and you have to use traction. If you don't use traction, then, you know, there's a problem there. So the approach, the portals are really the standard approaches. So you usually start off, you don't put traction initially, and you can see how the, you know, I'm using my belly to actually position the foot, okay? So I can dorsiflex and plantar flex the foot as required using my abdomen touching the foot of the patient. You want to put insufflate the joint with a needle, just put about 5 to 10 ml of fluid in it, and so that it expands the space. So when you put in your scope, you don't tend to injure the surface. The medial portal is just next to the tibialis anterior tendon. You don't want to, you know, at this area, you have the saphenous vein just midway between the tib ant and the there. So you don't want just remain close to the tib ant tendon, but you don't want to injure the sheath of the tendon because that can cause tendonitis and pain in the tendon. So you don't want to do that. And you remain in the joint. So you see the scope is actually pointing horizontally. And so you want to go to the as parallel to the joint as possible, and then you go on and make the lateral incision. It's a you just use an artery. It's a small, just skin incision. The superficial peroneal nerve can be marked out. You can see that the superficial peroneal nerve has been marked out. Usually, you can mark it out using flexing the fourth toe, and then you can sometimes make it stand out. But majority of times, you can't really make that out very well. So if you see from inside the joint, then usually you want to avoid any structures which are visible. So any veins away, you can go away from them and make your incision there. Obviously, now, if you see, we are dorsiflexing the foot using the tummy. So whenever you put the scope in or whenever you put any instrument inside the joint, this is for all cases of ankle arthroscopy. You don't injure the joint or the weight-bearing cartilage. So, and you have the dorsum of the anterior part of the ankle is relaxed when you dorsiflex. So there's more space for the scope and the shaver to be there in the same confined space that is there in ankle. The main difference between the ankle and knee scope is the space that in the ankle is very limited. So you have to use smaller instruments sometimes to actually get in two instruments at the same time, because usually you have to withdraw the scope and then put in the shaver to get actually both of them in the same view. So it's that is the main learning curve of the ankle arthroscopy as compared to the knee scopy. So once you've done that, you've opened up, you know, you will see a gush of fluid that comes out, and then basically you've got the two portals. These are the two standard portals that you need for the preparation of the joint. So, and then once you put in the shaver, initially you will see a lot of, you know, synovitis, especially in this case, and you can see that the joint cartilage, look at the tibial side there, there's a lot of grade 4 changes in the cartilage, and so this patient, we've applied traction. The traction, you can use a special traction strap. And if you have a postgraduate to pull on the leg, that's great. Otherwise, you can use, you know, because that's much more convenient than actually putting a static traction, which I don't like, with a special traction device, because then you don't have the maneuverability of actually dorsiflexing the ankle midway during the operation. So I tend to use my postgraduate for traction, and you just use a proprietary ankle arthroscopy strap, which is available, and you start debriding away. In an ankle arthroscopy fusion, you really don't need to care because, you know, you don't need to protect any cartilage. You have to actually get it all off. So you can go away with your shaver, with your burr. So this is the barrel burr, which you see. This is a 4 mm barrel burr, okay? So you can use that and just debride away the cartilage and the part of the subchondral bone, which is thick subchondral bone, you have to take off. Notice that in an ankle arthroscopy preparation, you will have a lot of ridges, okay? And that's quite normal. If you have a flat surface, that's not ideal for an ankle arthrodesis. So you need to have ridges in the preparation, and that helps the ankle interlock, the two surfaces interlock when you fix them. And it's been shown that if you have a flat surface versus a ridge surface, the ridge surface is better for fusion and more stable. So you basically, it is just a game of patience. You just have to go and debride that. The first case, in the initial few cases that I did, you know, about 10 years ago, maybe, you know, sort of took me 2 hours or so on average in a case. And then now it takes me just 15 minutes for the whole joint preparation, really. So it's sort of, you know, gradually you go fast and fast, and then you can, you know, go more practice. But it takes time. It's got a steep learning curve. So this is the lateral girder. You can see the fibula on this side. So I do tend to pray the lateral girder as well. In some cases, you can actually choose to leave the lateral girder alone and just prepare the top and the medial gutter, especially in cases where, you know, in post-traumatic arthritis, where the fibula is well aligned and there's no arthritis in the lateral gutter part. So you can retain some of the lateral gutter movement, the fibular movement that is there, which is the external rotation and translation of the fibula. And you can just fuse the medial gutter and the main weight-bearing part of the talus and tibia. And so, but in cases where like this rheumatoid arthritis, you want to repair the lateral gutter as well. And this is the medial side. So you can see it's so much synovitic. It is because it's rheumatoid, the bone is soft, the cartilage is easily removable, okay, and doesn't take much. Sometimes you need to have small instruments like curettes, which you want to put curettes because it's so hard bone. And you want to get all the cartilage out very nicely. You want to go to the subchondral bone, bleeding bone. And you see here that, you know, eventually that this whole thing has been prepared. And you can see the ridges. It's not a smooth surface. It's all ridge surface. And that's what we want. Really, you want to go from the whole back to the front of the ankle joint. Everything has to be prepared. And then you can use the microterol to drill some holes in the both sides of the tibia and talus. And that completes the preparation. Sometimes, as Paolo said, we need to feather it. So I can put an osteotome and try and feather the joint. Even arthroscopically, you can put a small osteotome in and feather the joint. So that's a good technique. Then you release the tunicate. Look for any non-bleeding spots, something like this. The cartilage in front has been left. So you want to remove all the non-bleeding areas. You want to look for the bleeding areas you're happy about, but the non-bleeding areas you want to, you know, debride further. And this is the standard fixation that I use. Is basically, I use a first screw is the medial screw, which is this one. And you want to put it from the back and go towards the neck of the talus. This is called the home run screw. This provides one thing. It provides that, you know, it pushes the talus, pulls the talus back where you want the talus to be actually back in the ankle mortise to get the Achilles tendon good motion off of the Achilles. So you want the talus as back as possible. And this screw first allows you to do that, is to pull the talus back into the mortise. So this is the screw. This can be become more horizontal. So you can start a bit more distally here, and then you can go into the tilonactyl here. So that is the screw which starts medially. And then you can put the lateral screw as well, which then passes, goes towards the back of the joint. So, and then, so these don't cross at the level of the joint. You can add this screw, although majority of times I don't use this screw, just use a two screw construct. The other screw, if you have a bigger bone, you know, it's a male patient, sometimes a bigger bone, you can add on a medial screw further, another medial screw. Okay. But that's, you know, for Indian patients, usually two screws are good enough. And you get really solid fixation. If the bone is very, very osteoporotic, then you would want to add more screws. And maybe you want to, you know, sometimes in one patient, I even added a fixator for 6 weeks, a bridging fixator to allow the bone to heal. But it's all done minimally invasive. So these screws are done percutaneously. You don't need any open incision. And so so this is at 2 months, I usually get a CT scan. And you can see bridging bone already there. It's completely already bridged off. And, you know, it's all healed up at 2 months, full webbing. So that's the post-op protocol that I follow. Is I give a plaster, non-red bearing for 4 weeks. I do a check X-ray at that time, start partial red bearing in a walker boot. I get a CP at 2 months. If there is bridging bone, I allow them full red bearing in a boot. A boot I tend to keep till about 3 months. The chances of a non-union in an ankle arthrodesis are high. Okay, so it's really, you need to be really careful about, I think the thing that matters the most is joint preparation. As Paolo as well as previous speakers, joint, if you don't prepare the joint, you know, nothing is going to be adequate. And the various studies have shown that the incidence of non-union and ankle arthrodesis can be as high as 10%, which is really high. So if 1 in 10 patients goes into a non-union, it's not a good result, is it? So, but with arthroscopic ankle arthrodesis, the chances of that has gone down. Even with open arthrodesis, if you prepare the joint well, the chances, you know, the average non-union rate goes down to about 2-3%. So, I think that's, and you get the patient going. At 3 months, everything should be off. The goal is to get, you know, a patient achieve union of that. So if you look at a couple of studies, really, so if you look at this 2016 study in General Foot and Ankle Surgery by John Kennedy and Yu Chu Tsai, they reviewed 7,000 cases of an open arthrodesis and 1,000 cases of arthroscopic arthrodesis. And they found that there was no statistical difference in non-union rates between the two. 8.7% in the open group and 7% in the arthroscopic group. So it's still in high, but this included studies of patients from way back. They found that there was a higher incidence of adjacent joint arthrodesis in the open group. But the main thing is it open versus arthrodesis, it was not really much difference in the non-union rates. Systematic analysis, systematic review and a meta-analysis in 2020, they included studies from as far back as last 20 years and looked at three RCTs. They found that the arthroscopic arthrodesis was associated with a higher fusion rate as compared to open, a smaller estimated blood loss, a shorter tunicate time. So actually they found the opposite of what, you know, that they had a shorter tunicate time with an arthroscopic arthrodesis and a shorter length of hospitalization. So earlier recovery for as you grow, you know, with experience, I think the earlier cases will take more time than an open surgery. Definitely you have to first 10, 20, 50, even 30, 40 cases may take more time than an open surgery. But as you gradually build an experience, I think you will eventually find that you do these much more quickly with very little incisions and with a higher fusion rate if you do them properly, if you prepare the joint well. The main thing is you have to reach the bleeding bone, do a microfracture, do chamfering, do feathering if you need to. If you have subchondral bone, you have to do all that to actually achieve a union in these cases. So benefits is a higher union rate, early recovery, less blood loss, shorter operative time, and suitable for patients with a compromised soft tissue envelope. So if you have a compromised envelope, you don't want to do an open surgery, you can do an arthroscopic ankle arthrodesis. So but ideally, the patient should not have a significant deformity, and there is a learning curve as we discussed with this. So thanks for the invitation again. Thank you very much.